Hey, life-changing church, North Rock Church, where you are. It is November. It is Christmas season, whether you feel like it is or not, because we are going big and we are going together. Today, I am out here. We have been dreaming and planning and putting together Christmas Town, what it's going to look like. Got a plan in place. We are going big, so we are going to need all kinds of help. We're going to start this Sunday with stringing up some lights and getting some things ready to go. Just go with me for just a moment.
Drum roll, please.
Think about pulling into our drive here in Angola campus into Christmas Town, and it's a light display all the way down our driveway. And as we get around to the end of the drive, you're going to see an amazing sight. It's going to be a beautiful display where you can get yourself some hot chocolate, get yourself nice and warm and toasty so that you can turn the corner and you hit the front of the building, which is filled with lights.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Beautiful, beautiful lights in the middle in our island here. You got displays, you've got people skating on some ice. It's gonna be an amazing, amazing thing. And as you come around the corner, you're gonna find yourself at another display where you're going to be able to get yourself some popcorn and some chocolate, maybe some cookies. Why would you want to have popcorn? What, popcorn doesn't make sense at Christmas time? Oh, but it does, my friends, because as we are beginning to turn the corner, coming back down this driveway, we're going to get around the corner and you're going to see my friends here are part of the development right there, Joel. And there you
Christmas
go.
Town!
Christmas it's Town!
Christmas
baby.
Town!
I don't even know if I should tell you this, but this is gonna be amazing. You see that parking lot? It's gonna be awesome because it's gonna be filled with cars. Why? Because we're gonna have some movie screens and we're gonna show some Christmas movies. That's why you want the popcorn. You're gonna have some hot chocolate, some popcorn. You can pull into one of these parking spots and reminisce.
Joy to the world.
And then as you exit down our driveway, ton of lights. It's gonna be awesome.
Santa's coming to town.
Santa! Throughout the month of November, we're gonna be decorating. We're gonna be putting things together. We want you to be a part of this. We want you to come with us because we're gonna do some amazing displays. It's gonna be bright, it's gonna be beautiful, and it's gonna be filled with joy. That's what this is all about. We're gonna do it together. This Sunday after service, we are going to begin putting some lights up, and we're excited about being able to do this with you. We appreciate you, we love you. This Christmas season, we are going big and we're going together. We'll see you guys.
Family. I'm Selena and I am the Church Where You Are coordinator, and I am here today to tell you that we are so excited about what is happening at Church Where You Are right now. Our numbers have been up on churchwhereyouare.online.church, and we just love the opportunity to minister to you one-on-one, to be able to greet you, and to have a real personal church experience. So if you're joining us on YouTube or Facebook, that's okay, but the best place to join us is churchwhereyouare.online.church. And you might say, well, Selena, I can't stream churchwhereyouare.online.church on my TV. that's okay. Go ahead and stream from Facebook or YouTube, whatever works for your smart TV, but then have church where you are open on your phone so that you can interact with us one-on-one. That way we can pray with you one-on-one. We can just have a much better environment to minister to you without all the extra distractions. So we would love for you to join us at churchwhereyouare.online.church. That's where the party's at. And speaking of parties, the biggest party of the year is coming. Christmas! I love Christmas. And I'm sure you do too. And we would love for you to go big and go together with us this Christmas. So get signed up to help us decorate, to volunteer. We want you to be part of this huge thing that we're gonna do with our Angola Christmas Town experience, and then Christmas services and Edgerton. And then on December 26th, it's all about you. Us, this big Church Where You Are family. It's going to be everybody online, Church Where You Are, go big or go together. We are so excited. So get signed up today and join us, churchwhereyouare.online.church.
Hey, life-changing church, NorthRock Church Where You Are. It is November, it is Christmas season, whether you feel like it is or not, because we are going big and we are going together. Today, I am out here. We have been dreaming and planning and putting together Christmas Town, what it's going to look like. Got a plan in place. We are going big, so we are going to need all kinds of help. We're gonna start this Sunday with stringing up some lights and getting some things ready to go. Just go with me for just a moment.
Drum roll, please.
Think about pulling into our drive here in Angola campus into Christmas Town, and it's a light display all the way down our driveway. And as we get around to the end of the drive, you're going to see an amazing sight. It's going to be a beautiful display where you can get yourself some hot chocolate, get yourself nice and warm and toasty so that you can turn the corner and you hit the front of the building, which is filled with lights.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Beautiful, beautiful lights in the middle in our island here. You got displays, you've got people skating on some ice. It's gonna be an amazing, amazing thing. And as you come around the corner, you're gonna find yourself at another display where you're gonna be able to get yourself some popcorn and some chocolate, maybe some cookies. Why would you wanna have popcorn? Popcorn doesn't make sense at Christmas time. Oh, but it does, my friends, because as we are beginning to turn the corner, coming back down this driveway, we're gonna get around the corner, and you're gonna see my friends here are part of the development, right there, Joel, and there you go.
Christmas Town!
Christmas Town,
Christmas
baby!
Town!
I don't even know if I should tell you this, but this is gonna be amazing. You see that parking lot? It's gonna be awesome because it's gonna be filled with cars. Why? Because we're gonna have some movie screens and we're gonna show some Christmas movies. That's why you want the popcorn. You're gonna have some hot chocolate, some popcorn. You can pull into one of these parking spots and reminisce.
Joy to the world.
And then as you exit down our driveway, ton of lights. It's gonna be awesome.
Santa's coming to town.
Santa! throughout the month of November, we're going to be decorating. We're going to be putting things together. We want you to be a part of this. We want you to come with us because we're going to do some amazing displays. It's going to be bright. It's going to be beautiful. And it's going to be filled with joy. That's what this is all about. We're going to do it together. This Sunday after service, we are going to begin putting some lights up. And we're excited about being able to do this with you. We appreciate you. We love you. This Christmas season, we are going big and we're going together. We'll see you guys.
Family, I'm Selena and I am the Church Where You Are coordinator, and I am here today to tell you that we are so excited about what is happening at Church Where You Are right now. Our numbers have been up on churchwhereyouare.online.church, and we just love the opportunity to minister to you one-on-one, to be able to greet you, and to have a real personal church experience. So if you're joining us on YouTube or Facebook, that's okay. But the best place to join us is churchwhereyouare.online.church. And you might say, well, Selena, I can't stream churchwhereyouare.online.church on my TV. That's okay. Go ahead and stream from Facebook or YouTube, whatever works for your smart TV, but then have Church Where You Are open on your phone so that you can interact with us one-on-one. That way we can pray with you one-on-one. We can just have a much better environment to minister to you without all the extra distractions. So we would love for you to join us at churchwhereyouare.online.church. That's where the party's at. And speaking of parties, the biggest party of the year is coming. Christmas! I love Christmas, and I'm sure you do too, and we would love for you to go big and go together with us this Christmas. So get signed up to help us decorate, to volunteer. We want you to be part of this huge thing that we're gonna do with our Angola Christmas Town experience, and then Christmas services in Edgerton, and then on December 26th, it's all about you, us. This big church where you are family. It's gonna be everybody online, church where you are, go big or go together. We are so excited. So get signed up today and join us, churchwhereyouare.online.church.
Together, the church is better together. Across boundaries and borders, beyond walls and notions, we're part of something far more powerful, far more potent than any of us could ever fully imagine or dream. A mission far bigger than any of us could ever accomplish on our own. We exist to make Jesus known. And in that pursuit, we become the best version of who God created us to be. A reflection of His love, His truth, His grace, His hands, His feet. One in mission, one in heart, one in love for Jesus and people, arms locked to serve, give, and show the world His love, which has no equal. And when we do, God goes before us. Hope rises. People turn their feet to Jesus. Families grow stronger. Communities come together. Lives forever change for the better. Victory is won. This is church. This is together. This is who we are. It's what we were made for. And all the glory goes to the one who makes it all possible. Jesus. To His name be all the glory, honor, and praise. Welcome to the movement, 2,000 years in the making. Welcome to church.
Hey, what is up, everybody? Welcome to church where you are today. It's Sunday, November 7th. And I say the date because dates matter when it comes to decorating. Am I right? Especially on your door. I am on my front porch. We're getting ready for church where you are today. But where are you watching from? We want to know. Our hosts are hanging out in the chat. They want to know that you're new. So say I'm new in the chat. Our hosts are ready to make you feel comfortable, cared for, and informed. So don't be shy. And if you create an account at our online platform, did you know that you can private chat us? Whether during or after service at 9 or 11, live, it's really cool. It's our virtual church lobby. Unfortunately, it doesn't sync with Facebook or YouTube. So you gotta click that link in the chat to join us at the party. All right, so I need some advice. Everybody, we're decorating the front door. Do we go with a Thanksgiving wreath or a Christmas wreath? What do you say? I don't know, are you that Christmas person? Or are you staying in that turkey cornucopia zone until after, you know, I don't know what the dates are. I just do what my wife tells me to do. All right, I know you're all hamming it up in there in the chat. That's a Christmas pun. We're really off to a great start today, everybody. But I'm making an executive decision. We're gonna go with the Thanksgiving wreath. We're actually in a series that works right with it. Brand new series, 4 weeks. You're gonna wanna make sure you tune into the very end. That last weekend is Thanksgiving weekend. Big announcement. If you're near a physical campus, that would be the weekend to not go to church where you are and to go to the physical campus. But if you're only online and you're at church every week at church where you are online, hey, we got a big announcement in the chat. You're not gonna wanna miss it, so tune in. Well, we are going big and we are going together this Christmas season, as you have heard, and there are lots of volunteering options, opportunities to get with us, whether online or in person, to get into that Christmas spirit. Check the chat right now or download the Church Center app. All the details are right there so you can jump on a decorating crew, a welcome crew near you. All right, my crew is inside waiting because worship is about to start. So I'm gonna head on in and see you guys after service.
I've seen stories that have proved your faithfulness. I've seen miracles the mind can't comprehend. And there's beauty in what I don't understand. Jesus, it's you. Jesus, it's you. Let's all sing. Oh, I believe you're the wonder working God. You're the wonder working God. All the miracles I've seen, you're too good to not believe. You're the wonder working God. And you heal because you love. All the miracles I've seen, you're too good to not believe. Resurrect a man with my own hands. Just the mention of your name can raise the dead. So all the glory to the only one who can. We say, Jesus, it's you. Jesus, it's you. We say, so I believe you're the one. I've seen cancer disappear. I've seen brokenness restored. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. I've seen real life resurrection. I've seen mental health restored. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. We'll see families reunited. See prodigals return. Don't you tell me he can't do it.
Don't you tell me he can't do it.
We will see troubled souls delivered. I've seen addicts finally free. Don't you tell me he can't do it. We're gonna sing that again.
He can't do it.
We'll see families reunited. I see prodigals return. You tell me he-
God, your love is living and breathing in our lives today. We sing this out to you. Everybody sing this out.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. And who could imagine so great a mercy? And what heart could fathom such boundless grace? And the God of ages steps down from glory.
Active in every room today, Jesus. We declare that here today. God, be our living home. God, be our living and breathing home. Come on, everybody, sing this out. Declare this today. You're my living home. And I believe it. You're my living home.
Just sound so good today. As we're worshiping there, I just couldn't help but think of these words that are written in Galatians chapter 3 by the Apostle Paul. He said this. He said, before the coming of this faith that we have, we were held in custody under the law, locked up until the faith that was to come would be revealed. I think about in my life all the times that I tried to be perfect or I tried to get it right on my own. And I love as we worship, it's just a reminder of what it says here as Paul continues in verse 26. But in Christ Jesus, you are all made children of God through faith. For all of you were baptized into Christ, you have clothed yourself with Christ in that. You know, last week we celebrated baptisms here at Church Where You Are, and we had many people that made the decision to be baptized. They'd been through our journey class and begun walking with Jesus. And I think about all the great things that God is doing week in and week out through people like you who are living your life on purpose for a purpose. And that's why we're going to continue our worship right now through a time of giving. And this is the time when we affirm our trust in God. As children of God, as the provider and the giver of every good thing in our life. You know, week in and week out, what we do here at Church Where You Are, these baptisms and lives being changed, people being adopted into the family of Jesus, finding faith and hope and love in Him. It all happens because people like you have made a decision. You don't want to live your life just purposeless. You don't want to live your life just kind of going through the motions. No, you actually want to make a difference in the life of another. And that's what you do every time that you support the mission financially here at Church Where You Are. You can give today in a very simple, easy way. Simply by opening your mobile device, like you're sending a text, and texting an amount to 84321. Again, you can use your mobile device right now to give simply by sending a text to this number, 84321. Put your amount in that text. It'll ask you to choose your church, and each week at that point, giving will be as easy as sending a text. It's safe, it's effective, and wow, it's an incredibly powerful way for you to make an impact in the life of another. So text now, 84321 with your amount. Thank you so much for your gift and generosity today. I just want to pray over that giving today that God would bless it, that He would bless your life for the blessing that you are to the life of another, because believe it or not, that is His promise, that if we will faithfully give, if we'll faithfully be a blessing to another person, help them find the freedom in Christ, that He will bless our lives. I want to pray that God would do just that today. Will you pray with me as we give? God, we are so, so thankful. Even as we worship today, we're celebrating our freedom in Jesus. this pursuit of perfection and trying to carry the weight of the world on our own shoulders. It's not been a pursuit that's been enjoyable in our life. In fact, it always leads us back to realizing that we're not enough. We don't have all the answers, and we need you. And so, Jesus, I thank you. Even last week for the celebration that was had where people are coming to faith in you, being baptized, and deciding that they want to live their lives on purpose, for a purpose. God, today, for all of us, I pray that you would use this giving now that we bring to you. We bring it with a glad and sincere heart, trusting that you want to use this to make a difference in the life of another. So God, our prayer today is that you would bless it, that you would use it, you would make Jesus known through it, the hope and love that he so freely gives us, the grace he gives us. And God, I pray for every single giver today that you would bless their life for the blessing that they are to the life of another. All the promises of your word, God, I pray that you would pour those out in their lives in ways that they would see them each and every day. We love you. We thank you for this opportunity to give. We get to do this, and we love you for the opportunity. All the glory goes to you, Jesus. We pray in your name. And everybody said, amen. Well, we're starting a brand new series today called Gratitude Adjustment, and I'm excited about what God is going to do in our lives over these next 4 weeks leading up to Thanksgiving. So get here every single week, share this video up even now, and let's get ready for a little tune-up when it comes down to our gratitude. Welcome to Gratitude Adjustment.
Oh, that's hot.
Seriously?
Hey, honey, are you taking things for granted again?
Yeah, I guess so.
All right, well, is there anything you can do about that? Because we really need to do some laundry.
Well, hey, Church Online, church where you are, I hope you're gathered with some people for church today. We want you to have church where you are. Well, I'm so glad to be with you today and bring you the very first week of our new series called Gratitude Adjustment. We're going to look at some adjustments in our life that we need to have towards gratitude. I mean, now this is the month. November is the month, right? That we start thinking about it. We start thinking about being thankful. It's Thanksgiving's coming. Maybe sometimes we only think of that on Thanksgiving Day. But now's the time we kind of start shooting that way. We're thinking about being thankful. And, you know, we start posting things on social media about being thankful and, you know, make all kinds of pictures and things like that. And, we're just funny like that. And, you know, our thought is in this series is, so what if we could create a heart, if we could adjust our hearts towards gratitude, if we could take a look at that. And so wouldn't it be awesome that if we lived lives that were always thankful, that we didn't take thanks for granted. You know, I think we have to realize that when we're not thankful, that means we're taking things for granted. And when you stop and think about taking things for granted, boy, that just takes it another level. I mean, have you been around somebody that's not thankful, that's ungrateful? I mean, you've done something for them, and there was no thanks. There was nothing that followed it that you thought would follow it. And man, you're just looking at them like going, wow, you are so ungrateful. And then we step back and realize that I probably do the same thing. I mean, that's hard to admit, but we have to look deep inside and go, wow, when somebody does things for me, am I grateful? And you know, you might even say thank you, but not be thankful. And so it's something to look at. And the sad part about it is ungratefulness comes very natural to us. That's kind of the sad thing about it. And we have to take a deep look at this. And Paul obviously knows this is a big deal. And he obviously knows it's a thing of our sinful nature. In 2 Timothy, he lists some things. He said there will be terrible times in the end days. And then he begins to list what people will be like. He said people will be lovers of themselves. He said they'll be lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive. And then this word's in there, ungrateful. And unholy. So right in the middle of some of these words, boastful and proud, unholy, is this word ungrateful. And so obviously Paul's looking at this and going, this is a serious thing. This will affect your social interactions with people. This will affect your relationship with God. This being ungrateful is a big deal. And it knows that it even has some effects on our spiritual life. In our spiritual life, it could hurt our relationship with God because we're not thankful, and it could damage our souls. And you know, when you think about being ungrateful, one thing I think sometimes we do, and maybe it's even looking and going, I take it for granted, is salvation. It's what Jesus has done for us. I mean, do you find yourself taking that for granted that Christ died for you? And did we forget that? I mean, there was a time when we first turned our feet to Christ that we're so thankful for that. And then as we walk this journey, that we just kind of forget and we're not as thankful. But, you know, we need to be thankful that he died for us. And not only that, but that means we have eternity in heaven. And so, you know, I just see my own life. And I think that the older I get, the more I realize I've been ungrateful and that I've taken things, I just take things for granted in my life. And it seems like the older I get, those things seem to be more important. And it shouldn't be that way. You know, think about the things that you've taken for granted. What are some of those? Just make a mental note real quick, just a couple things that you go, wow, I've taken that for granted. I've taken them for granted. And it's amazing if you'd stop and think about and be honest about the things you've taken for granted of what they are. It's kind of a scary thing sometimes if we could be honest with ourselves. So how do we change this? How do we do some adjusting in our lives? And but as we think about what I have taken for granted, how do we do this? Well, number one is, as I've already said, it has to be an internal shift. We have to have this internal shift that's inside our souls and our hearts. The Bible says to guard your heart because everything in life flows from that. So we've got to have this shift. If we find ourselves being unthankful, ungrateful people, taking things for granted, we need to start here on the inside. And then next week, we're going to talk about how, because of that, how there's an external shift, meaning how we live, what people see in us, how we respond will be different because of this internal shift. We'll have an external shift. And then that will take us to another spot where we have this internal shift, we have an external shift, and then we will see blessings. We're going to talk the third week about the blessings of God and how then week one is internal shift, week two is external shift, week three is the blessings of God, and what will that create in us but a life of generosity. And so we're going to look at this over the next 4 weeks. It's a spiritual movement in our lives. It's rhythm. We talk about rhythm. Be grounded. You have to be grounded first and then create those things, create rhythm in our life. And so, you know, this is in a time of no matter what the circumstances are, because of the shift in the heart, the shift in the external, the realizing the blessings of God and becoming a generous person. Now, King David writes Psalm 23, and I think most of you are familiar with this very popular psalm. And you see something. You see an internal shift in David's life when he writes this. And he starts off by saying, "The Lord is my shepherd; I shall not want." And I mean, boom, right there, off the top at the beginning, he just states it. He says, "God's my shepherd." Just puts it out there, and because he's my shepherd, I will not want. Meaning that because he's my shepherd, he'll provide for me. God will provide. This shift in him happens where he puts all of his trust in God, and he realizes that the shepherd will lead me to food, will lead me to water, will be my defender, will be my caretaker. That's what the shepherd will do. The shepherd protects. And it's interesting to me as you look at this word shepherd throughout the scriptures, normally that's a low place. A shepherd is a low place, not one that's looked highly of. And yet God, and through the scriptures, has turned that around, just like Jesus has with everything, but he's turned that around and he's made this an honorable position in a position of importance. Here and obviously David says that. David says, "He's my shepherd." Man, that's a place of honor. That's a place of importance that he has a shepherd. Must have realized that he's not had a shepherd, or he wasn't following the right shepherd. And David acknowledges. So when David acknowledges that God's his shepherd, he also is acknowledging that he's a sheep. Now, that's not a real glorious thing to say that I'm a sheep if you know a lot about sheep, but David acknowledges that. David acknowledges that I'm walking on my own, I'm straying, and I need a shepherd. And I've declared that God is my shepherd. And he said, "I shall not want." That's a trust. Going, he's going to provide all of my needs that I have. And so he goes on and he says, "He makes me to lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul, and he leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." And if you look at the things here, as David declared that God's my shepherd, you look what he says. He takes me, and he knows, God knows when I need to rest. And so if I'm following him and he leads me to these places, he leads me beside still waters, that God knows when I need to be what restored. And so this rest brings restoration. And what the restoration is that it leads me in paths of righteousness. And so David's finding his life in a place where he's like going off the rails. His life's went sideways. And so he declares that God is his shepherd, and that I won't desire anything but what he has for me. And I know he's going to restore my soul. He's going to give me rest. You know, the scripture says, you know, those who you are heavy laden, that you're a burden, Jesus has come to me and I will give you rest. Make me your shepherd. Allow this internal shift to happen. And I love this because he says, not for your glory, but when people see all this happen, when people began to see this internal shift happen, that it brings glory to God and not to ourselves. And so he goes on. He says, "Yea, though I walk through the shadow of walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you're with me. your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And I want you to look at this, because he says, this is said, talked about throughout the Bible. There's going to be the valley of the shadow of death. Jesus said, when it rains, it's when it rains, not if it rains, that you're with me. And because you're with me, I'll fear no evil. And so you think about that sheep who is out there in the midst of danger, and yet how they're just grazing. They're just grazing. They're fearing no evil because the shepherd is the one watching. And I like this, because he says the rod and your staff. And, you know, I don't know about you, but I've needed the rod to poke me sometimes. I've needed the staff hook me and bring me back to where I need to be, put me back in line to where I need to be. And so, you know, gratefulness of the shepherd, being grateful, this shift in our lives, it leads me to places of rest and of comfort. Even in the midst of hard times, there can be rest there. There can be peace there. It talks about it. It says in Philippians 4, he says, worry about nothing, but in everything, through prayer, petitions, what's next? With thanksgiving, make your request known to God. And then prayer, petitions with a thankful heart, because only because of this shift that happens. And then you can experience the peace of God in the midst of these storms, in the midst of this. He goes on and it says, your presence, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil and my cup overflows. He's saying that even in the midst of all this, I'm going to have all and more than I need. God's going to provide for me. And he just will. So you look at this the scriptures and know where David's at. And he's got this shift going on in his life. This shift, the spiritual shift in his heart happening, where he's declaring God to be a shepherd and his provider. And that he can give thanks because God will lead him. And God will provide for him. And when God provides, you know, now because of this shift, he can have a thankful heart. And so, you know, you look at these things and he says, you know, you prepared, you, God. He acknowledges that God did this. You prepare. And this means that God cares. I want you to know that God cares. God cares for you. He cares for you. And then you look what it also says. It says it has the word me right there. The word me, that's personal. God cares. He cares. He prepares for you. It makes it personal. David's having this shift and it's becoming so personal to him. And he's saying, I eat in comfort. I eat in security. I live in comfort and security, even in the midst of darkness, because of my shepherd. What a shift. Because I tell you what, worry will take out a grateful heart. You know, it just will. Discouragement will take out a grateful heart. And those things overflow. So how do we get there? How do we make this happen? How do we have this internal shift in our lives where we become grateful people? And I think it starts right here. Surrender. David surrenders to God. He says, he declares, he's my shepherd. He's the one I'm going to follow. He's my provider. And I can trust him in even bad times and good times. And I'm just going to be able to trust him. And so look what Jesus says. Thomas asked this question. He said to Jesus, Lord, do we do not know where you're going. So how can we know the way? And Jesus' response was, I'm the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And so he's saying that the most important thing is to get to the Father. The most important thing in life. We're going to have a lot of stuff happen in life. But the most important is to get to the Father. And he says, I'm the way. I'm the way, Thomas. I am the way, the only way. I'm the truth, the only truth, and the life. And so he's saying, this is it right here. not there's not this way and that way and this way. And you know, sometimes people struggle with that, that they're like, I don't know if I'm okay with just one way. I don't know that I'm okay with that. And yet Jesus says, yeah, there's one way. And so we, instead of going, I wish there was other ways, we need to go, thank you, Lord, that you've brought provision, that you're the way. And I trust in that. And there's security in that. And look what he goes on to say in Luke. It says, then he said to them all, talking about his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. And so there's the surrender right there. Deny yourself. So if we choose to follow the shepherd, follow Jesus, the way, the truth, the life, he says you got to lay down your own will. You got to lay down and see the shift that's happening here, that it's not about us, that we're not trusting in our own leading and guiding ourselves, but we need him to lead us and guide us, and we need to follow him. He says, what good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit their very soul? So you can go off here and here and here and gain that and have this money and that car and this house and these friends and all that. And he says, what good is all that if you've lost your soul? If you've lost this here, and we need that shift in our lives. And so, you know, gratitude is driven by trust. There's such peace and thankfulness in the midst of making him your Lord and following him, surrendering to God and not our own. And so what's number two? Number two is listening. You can surrender all you want, but if you don't listen, what good is it? What good is it? And you remember what he said, that he leads me in paths of righteousness. That's God's ways in righteousness. And we can go where he leads us, but we have to listen. And look what it says in John. Jesus answered, I tell you, but you do not believe. I tell you, but you don't believe. He said, the works I do in my Father's name testify about me. I am who I am, is what he's saying. He says, but you do not believe, because here's why they don't believe, because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice and I know them and they follow me. So he's making this distinction of whether we're listeners or not, and that we're either he's our shepherd or he's not. And the way we know is if we listen, if we surrender. And now if we listen, he says, I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. And I and the Father are one. And he's saying, if you're my sheep, then you'll listen. My sheep will know my voice and I will know them, and we'll know whether we've surrendered, and we know whether we've listened. And he points out here that sheep will only recognize one voice, not many. And what did Jesus say? I'm the way. I'm the way. Listen to my voice. Know my voice. I'll know you. Follow me. And this is very much hooked to salvation. Will we follow him? Where's the path? Go on, the path of righteousness. You know, all these other things in life are going to happen, but what's the ultimate? The goal is eternal life. And, you know, I can't stress enough how you have to realize that the Word of God is the easiest way to listen. You know, people want to say, I need to hear from God. Well, right here. Right here is how we hear from God. It's printed right there. That's why we keep saying Bible engagement, Bible engagement, Bible engagement. So the last and the third way is to walk. So we surrender, we listen, and now we move. There's no sense of surrendering and listening if we don't move. You know, your kids can say, okay, you're dad, I hear what you say, but I don't do it. Well, the walk has to happen. Look what it says in Psalm 119. I love this scripture. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So it's listening to that, and it's going, okay, your word is that I'm going to follow. I'm going to follow what it says. I'm going to follow what it says about praying, not worrying, and praying and petitioning with a thankful heart. And then I'm going to know that peace. He says, I have taken an oath and confirmed it that I will follow your righteous laws. And I love that analogy in this. He didn't say your word is a spotlight. No, it says it's a lamp. And what that says to me is that it's a one step at a time. Listen, one step at a time. Listen, surrender, listen, step. Surrender, listen, step. And you know, so many times we want to see what's down the road, and I don't think we really want to know what's down the road. We probably can't handle what's down the road. And so you look at this package deal to have this internal shift, and it's basically, it's abiding, it's obedience, and then it's faith. It's surrender, it's listening, and it's walking. And so It's a tool that God uses, this grateful heart, this internal shift that needs to happen, that we become grateful that God's our shepherd, that we can trust in that. Gratefulness is trusting in Him, that where he's leading us is where He wants us. And gratitude gets the heart right, and it lines us up to God's will. I think gratitude will take us, or ungratefulness will take us off the road of where God wants to lead us, especially in the shadow of death. Well, we're not surrendering and listening and following His leading in the midst of trials and tribulations, but still having that grateful heart. I mean, it's hard enough to have a grateful heart in everyday life, let alone in the shadow of the valley of death. That's where He wants to lead us. That's why this internal shift has to happen. And I believe that gratitude breathes life into so many areas of our life. I believe it just breathes life into contentment, into selflessness, into courageous sacrifice, into proper perspectives. Think about that one. I believe it breathes life. Gratitude breathes life into peace and generosity that we're going to talk about, and joy and in hope in our worship and in our prayers. It's a big deal. This shift, this adjustment that we need. Colossians says, and let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, listen to what he says, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful. And always be thankful. That's what we're talking about. Not November, but always being thankful. And 1 Thessalonians says, always be joyful. Watch the connections here. Never stop praying. Be thankful in all circumstances. For this is God's will for you who belong to Christ Jesus, for you who have made Him your shepherd, and you who listen, and you who follow. So gratitude's a choice. It's a choice we have to make. Will we have that shift in our life, in that internal shift in our life? And next week you're going to see, we'll know whether we have by the external. But are you willing to do what David did, to surrender and to listen and to walk? Because you have to realize that we serve a good and loving God who knows how to give good things to His children, even in the valley of the shadow of death. And so I want to invite you to become His sheep, to make Him your shepherd, not part-time, not once in a while, but he's the voice you listen to. He's the voice that you recognize, and you hear Him through the days, whether good or bad. And the result of it is being grateful, because we're just trusting. We're trusting in the provisions. We're trusting that in His care. We're trusting in all those things that will generate, because of an internal shift, it will generate gratefulness, a life of gratefulness, and not taking things for granted. So I'd invite you today. Invite you today to follow Jesus. And maybe for the first time that you've never followed him. We talk about turning our feet, turning towards Christ, that we've all went that other direction where it was selfishness in our own way. And we just talk about turning our feet in the direction to Christ to follow him. And we began to see our heart change. Heart of gratefulness because of him. And maybe you find yourself where you've been very negative. And you're looking at the result of the heart, the external, which we'll talk about next week. But what's the external look like in your life? Have you turned towards yourself and not trusted in him to be your shepherd, to listen to him and to follow him? Maybe you're finding your life is sideways. And so it's time for a heart check. Question is, do you need some adjustments in the internal of our life? Let me pray for you. Father, we thank you for your direction and we thank you for your love for us. We thank you that you love us so much that you sent your son to die for us. That, Lord, that we can put our total trust in you and that you'll lead us and you'll guide us. So, Father, I just pray for those out there that are just feeling like they need some adjustments, need some internal adjustments, that they look at their life and they realize they're being ungrateful and they're taking so many things for granted. And we have to examine our lives and go, what's going on here? And so, Father, I just pray that as they take a hard look, that you'll meet them right where they are. And that, Father, they will just reach out to you. And that, Father, they will begin to hear your voice and follow it. So, Father, we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Pastor. Surrender, listen, and walk. That first step, turning your feet towards Jesus, it's all about surrender. From there, we listen and we get into God's revealed word, the Bible. We do that by putting it on our heart, and then we begin to walk that out through the power of God's Holy Spirit. So if you are turning your feet today towards Jesus, request prayer right now in the chat. It's private, and our online hosts, they will connect you with a pastor today. How about that second thing, listening? Well, we read and listen inside the Bible app, and this week, we've got a brand new reading plan. There is a group of people in there, in that app, every day of the week who want to read their Bible more, and you can interact with them each day. Happen to be alongside all of our pastors and leaders too. Lots of great stuff in there. Click that link in the chat to join or friend us up in YouVersion. Lastly, walk out that faith in the journey class. Hey, it is all about your journey. Your story matters to us. Get rooted and in rhythm with your faith. Our online classes begin tomorrow night at 7. There is still time for you to join. See the link in the chat for more info or ask one of our hosts in the chat and we'll get you connected. Well, we will see you back next week, everyone. Remember to get those pencils out. Service is over. Mark those calendars. Be here on Thanksgiving weekend, that Sunday. The big announcement. I told you, I can't tell you. I would lose my job. We want you to join our holiday team. Join us in decorating. We're doing stuff online and in person at our campuses, and we need a lot of help. So check to register to join us at the Church Center app. We just popped a link in the chat right now for you. Everybody, invite someone back to church next week. We'll see you. Bye-bye.